All right, so between that intro, which was terribly embarrassing, and following Matt Cutts, I think I'm like set up to fail here. But I'm excited. So hello, everyone. I'm Joanna Lord. I'm the director of acquisition for SEO Moz, which means I get to work in the awesome marketing team and talk about how we want to grow the customer base, grow the community, grow the brand, just reach as many people as we can about as many awesome things as we can. So. I'm tackling a really big topic today, something that I love talking about and something that we've spent a lot of time in the past couple months specifically really talking about internally. So CRO, who here does CRO at some point right now in their jobs? Awesome. How many of you think that you do CRO like really well? You think you've got like a process and you're really stoked with it? Nice, not one hand. So this is, I'm already winning. So like this is gonna be a huge success. Okay, so what I'm gonna try to talk about today is really rethinking the way that we've been doing it and try to think of a bigger way of tackling it. So I spent a lot of time running a lot of tests. I think we all have, and tests are great things. The problem with testing is it's very iterative. It can take a lot of time, it can take a lot of resources, both of which a lot of us don't have a ton of. So I'm hoping everyone leaves here today having written down a couple things. They can go back to their office or their desk or a coffee shop and say, I'm going to try to really rethink the way that we approach this as a company and come up with some cool stuff. So let's jump right in. I thought I'd start with a little history because, you know, it's always nice to go wander Wikipedia because that place is crazy. If you look at the real definition of where CRO started, it's pretty basic. When companies went online, when they tried to build a presence online, their existence and their longevity was completely dependent on whether or not they could start selling or actually accomplishing something online, right? This was the only way that they could justify putting more time into being online and making this website presence. Conversion rate optimization was born out of the need for lead generation. Primarily, kind of e-commercers were really focused on it. And they were really focused on website results, not anything off the website, right? It was all about that one experience and making it as great as it can. The problem with that, see here. Boop. I always do that. I point this at here, like out into the, this isn't Wi-Fi. But there's a problem with that, right? Is like, that's not real. No one in this room rolls into work and says, I only care about lead forms, that's it, nothing else, and I only care about my website and what happens just on the website. That just doesn't exist anymore. For the last couple days, I know we've all been talking a lot about what an SEO does and how our job has evolved, and how it involves a lot more things. And I think that that's what we're gonna be talking about today. So if it's not just about leads, what else is it about? Oh, this might be a problem. So we want a lot of this, right? We gotta throw the shoes up. We want a lot of social engagement. We care if they're reading reviews, we care if they're writing reviews, we care if they're liking us, we care if they look at other things and create, we care about the accounts and inviting friends and building a presence on our site. All of this is now in our wheelhouse. We also care about this, bundling, getting them to be loyal members, getting them to join programs we have and select other products of ours and explore, go deeper into the site, time on site. We also care about a lot of things like this, where we care about getting off of the website, go mobile, download this app, let's take it to the tablet, right? Let's get them to go over to Facebook and you know, integrate there so we can get a lot more data. I mean, Sephora's got a TV channel. Since when as a marketer been sitting down and thought to myself, how am I gonna optimize for them to come to our site and go watch Sephora TV? This is a totally different task at hand, right? We want more of everything, and we don't just want it, we have to have it, or we're not going to be the best marketers that we can be. We're not gonna get paid the most, we're not gonna get to build great teams and work on awesome projects. We have to do so much more than we've ever done. And so we don't just do e-commerce. So the sites themselves, even if you are in e-commerce and you come in, you care about a lot more than just a purchase and a product. You care about things like collaborating and getting them to actually do other activities on the site. So think about the marketing team behind Pinterest, right? They come here, what are they getting their users to do? They want them to contribute. Their livelihood is completely dependent on whether or not people categorize their pictures. I love that I put Pinterest up there because Laura called it out. I have 3,000 pins plus on this site. I don't categorize a thing. That's a problem, because Pinterest is gonna start selling advertising, and it will be completely dependent on whether or not they got all their users to categorize. So they need to start optimizing so that I do that more somehow. I need to invite people or they're not going to last, right? That's a possibility. Yes, they had this huge growth, but unless they start getting people to have that traction to come back and invite other people and do what they need to so they can monetize it, the site won't have the life that it deserves. And you also look at other sites. Like, I'm not sure, maybe I should switch back to the other clicker. Yeah, I think I'm gonna, technical moments, let's try this. Things like Coca-Cola, right? They do complete microsite strategies where it's all about philanthropy or it's all about a cause, completely separate than what a marketing team might be doing on Coca-Cola.com. They have sites like this where they're trying to get people to commit to things and evangelize things, share things, totally different tasks at hand. And The Verge, right? Our VP of marketing loves this site, got me totally addicted. It's all about content curation. What's the goal here? What are they trying to get them to do? Getting them to try to read it, to comment, to join? It's a totally different string of actions that we need to get people to do, which require different tests. So today's marketer does a little bit of everything. And we don't just need website results. We don't spend our day on just the website. In fact, if you ask Jen, who's in the front row here, most of her day isn't actually on the website, right? She's spending it in all these other networks doing all these other things that directly tie to whether or not we're successful as a company. People like REI, I love this. I was talking to John earlier. This entire section is about getting people to join classes, offline, walk into the store. So historically, if you think about it, the traditional marketer might have had a hard time adapting when things moved online to understanding digital marketing and understanding how they can be successful. Now there's this whole mass of digital marketers that we have all these awesome skills on how to optimize a website, and now we're asked to drive things offline. And it's challenging, right? The attribution's there. We're starting to make some real gains on how we can figure out what's successful between the two. But you need to understand those touch points. I was talking to John. He said that his team at REI really focused on this. Sites like this, Seattle's Children's Hospital. I'm not sure if you guys can see this, but it's about volunteering. Getting someone to physically pick up a phone, mark in their daily planner that they want to go save the world. That is on our plates. That's now our challenge. And then Julep, right? So this is a local Seattle company. They have nail parlors. They sell a product online as well. It's a monthly membership. But they also do this. They are driving people to book an appointment, but to also come and visit their parlors. This is part of their longevity. So I think you guys are getting where I'm going with this. Marketers today really need to improve a lot of things. And what was CRO back then really isn't CRO anymore. And in the past year and a half, I feel like when I get into a room and I'm like, I'm going to really start dedicating some time and resources to testing, I feel like it's such different questions than what I ever used to have to tackle. And so you might be thinking something like this, what the hell, where do I start then? If I'm supposed to do all of this, if I'm supposed to be in charge of improving things, where do I even start? And I think that there's some things that we can do. First off, we're going to take a deep breath. And then I think it's really critical to kind of rethink what CRO means at your company. Rethink what you do when you get into a room and decide you're going to start some testing. So what should we be spending our time on? This is the question, right? Because we all have so much extra time to throw at things like optimization and improvement. I'm going to run through 10 things that I think are worth improving. 10 pretty big ideas. 10 things that we are specifically working on at SEO Moz that like really get me excited, creative, also freak me out a little bit because sometimes it's not always the things that people at your company want to test. And hopefully some of these work for you guys as well. Number 10 is your story. This one is so important. The thing about it is, no one ever thinks about testing your story. No one ever says, I'm going to improve our story. I'm going to improve the way we show it. I'm going to improve how we present it. I'm going to improve how it's consumed and shared. Because as marketers, we kind of assume that's the brand marketer's job, or maybe it's the CEO's job, or the E-team's job. And in marketing, we actually were tackled with this a couple months ago. Like, how are we going to improve our story? How do we want the world to see us? We throw it in the About Us section, you know, and it's kind of this corner idea. And maybe you get up some contact and a timeline, and you're like, people know our story. But is that enough? And I'm here to say it isn't. So this is one of the favorite things that I've come across in the past year. How many people have seen Simon Sinek's TED Talk on the Golden Circle Theory? Wow, so it's great to see people have seen it. This is by far, if there's only one thing you take from everything I say today, other than I don't know how to use a clicker, is that this is a TED Talk you have to go see. It's called The Golden Circle Theory. Here's the concept behind the whole thing. So what? Products and services. This is where most of marketers spend their time. And I would say, until about 2 years ago, 80% of my testing time was there. How do I show off products? How do I make the product look the best, make the most sense for them, be the one that answers all their needs? How do I make it look the most cost-effective, the least risk? It was all about the product and selling the product. And my tests were in this circle. The problem is, it's not enough. If you look at how, that's your value prop, and we'll talk a little bit more about it in a second. This is how do you do it, right? So at SEO Moz, we actually don't do an awesome job of right now presenting the how. The how is the data story, right? How do we present tools? We do it with this awesome data. We do it with this awesome data team. We do it with this awesome customer service team. We do it with a great product pipeline. But we don't share as much of that as we could. That's something we're going to try to do in the future. So think about that. What could you be testing to show the how? But this gold part is where the magic happens. And this is something that really blew my mind, and that's the why. So we all know the reason we get up in the morning. And hopefully, it's because you really believe in the brand that you're working for. Hopefully, it's because you really think that they're doing something that's so awesome and epic that the world needs to see it. At SEO Moz, we're trying to make the web a better place. We're trying to make marketing an awesome thing, help people be proud of the way they market. Those are big sentences. Try to find them on our website right now, right? It's kind of a challenge to get that integrated, lacing it in all the pages so it's not invasive, but it's still present. And those are the sorts of tests you should run. It's not about a byline or an adjective. That's not your story. That's marketing copy. But the story is how everything ties together, where you put that mission statement, who says it, what medium do you use to put it in? Is it a video? Is it an image? Is it just copy? Is it buried in a footer? Is it in an about section? So think about how you can test getting your story in people's faces. Because that's the shit that gets people back to your site today. That's the stuff that people care about and actually send and share with other people. So I gave some examples here. This is a great one, okay? So this is some company's story. Empower people to change the way the global economy works. That's amazing. Like, if I woke up in the morning and was like, I just think I'm gonna go like change the global economy. Because who doesn't wanna do that today, right? This is like a Tuesday, I'm gonna go try that. Etsy, fail. I love Etsy, and this is their mission statement, and fail, this is the only place they talk about it. Absolute hashtag lame pants. And if you see, like, at the icons, and look at this, I mean, it's effective in the sense that it isn't unclear. But does it grab you? Do you need to share this page? Do you need to tweet at Etsy and say, I am so stoked about what you're doing. I love supporting this company. Absolutely not. If you look at this one, empower people around the world with a $25 loan. You might already have guessed the company. You probably have guessed the company because they do a great job of showing off what they do. So this is Kiva. This is their homepage. Right there in your face, pictures of people's faces, right? Empower the world. How do I know I'm empowering the entire world? Because the entire world is being shown in different cultures and where they are and how it's being used. I'm drawn in. I'm already gonna go deeper on the site. I'm already gonna link to it a lot more. Probably gonna bring it up in a blog post. All of the beautiful organic things that we've talked about with inbound happen when you put your story in people's faces. So think about that. How can you test that, right? All right, number 9, your pillars. This is one of my favorite ones because this really ticks off people when you bring it up in meetings, and it's really exciting. I think dialogue is a fun thing in teams. So when it comes to your pillars when it comes to your website is the concept of what has never changed. Likely, these are the things that your CEO drafted up when it was like when he was working in his office, out of his house, and was like, this is how my website's gonna look, and maybe it's a navigation piece, maybe it's where he put the phone number, maybe it's how he presented his story. These are the pillars, the things your website was built on. These are the things that when you say, I wanna test some stuff on this page, and you go talk to your designer, and the designer starts the mock-up, and the mock-up already has stuff in it, and you're like, I thought that we would maybe like change some of those things, and he was like, oh, no, you get this real estate. Go ahead and get crazy in that real estate, right? And that's beyond the pillars. You need to ask about these. You need to test these. And it's a hard conversation to have. So say I wanted to go find a data storage company. And I go and I find a site like this, justcloud.com. I guarantee you they have not really tested their pillars. They have not tested the lead form on top of the fun cloud. They've probably not tested this top nav or this three-pronged approach to description. Which is a shame, because that should probably be tested and validated. They might have tested the copy that went in it, or whether or not they show off a computer versus a tablet. Like, those aren't really CRO tests. Those are like, just, I don't even know what those are, pathetic examples of a CRO test, right? Because that won't change the bottom line. It probably won't change much. It could help a little boost, right? It might capture a couple of eyes. but it won't necessarily change the future of your company. If you look at someone like Dropbox, similar space, they have tested their pillars. This is a dangerous move, and I guarantee you when it first came up in a room and they were like, this is how we're gonna do it. It's just gonna be watch a video and a download button. And some guy over there who was like all about the pillars was like, no, it's not, you know? And then he quit a couple weeks later and now they're huge. So it totally works out, right? Because I think that when you come to testing your pillars, the bigger things are harder to get buy-off on, but when people buy off on the idea that they're gonna test something so fundamental, it gets really exciting. Everyone is committed to that test. So here's some examples. Again, looking at makeup, right? Like Lancome is a European brand, amazing makeup. They could do so much. Guarantee they have not tested that much because they have the most boring expected site experience that you would for a brand like this. Look at someone like MAC. That is ballsy, right? Because it is a very bright-faced, like bright-colored, very makeup-intense person. This is their persona. Is it the best user experience at first glance? Probably not. But they tested it, and I think that's really impressive. And this really does say to them, we're gonna throw out what we know to be unique about us, and hopefully people respond, and if they don't, we'll fix it. We'll iterate fast. When you get to challenging these really big ideas, all of a sudden you realize that you've kind of put your company in a momentum of testing. Because if it fails, they have to react fast. So I think that there's some sort of positive piece just to experience there. All right, number eight, your relationships. This one's gonna seem a little strange because testing your relationships seems outside our wheelhouse, seems very biz dev side of things, or possibly your sales team side of things, or maybe even your e-team side of things. But I think as marketers, as we all know, so much of our job these days is about relationships. You're all SEOs, you understand the concept of outreach and how critical the right relationships are. So what have you done to test your relationships lately? So what do I mean by that? Here's a great example. And I told Andrew earlier I was going to bring him up. I don't know where he is in the audience, but he's somewhere here. So there he is. So Andrew is our biz dev lead at SEO Moz. And he came in, he started, you know, over a year ago now, and he came in and he's like, we need to rethink how we present partners. And we had a partner page at the time, and it kind of showed off some of the people we worked with. And I remember being like, the hell, we are gonna change the way our partner page looks. Because to me, it was like, if we start changing that, how will it affect the partnerships? What will happen to this new, you know, pro perks experience that he was pitching? Like, how are we gonna have control over those relationships? And how are those different than our partners that we currently have? And all these questions popped up, and I really freaked out just from the sheer volume of change. But then he launched Pro Perks, and it's given us a completely different avenue to showcase partners, to start conversations with new partners, to reevaluate old partners. Are you still getting what you should be getting? Are both of you still matching your audiences? Companies change, but yet a lot of our partnerships are the same. The target audiences change, and you have to ask yourself, when we're linking to each other, we're giving each other real estate on our sites, is it still as valuable as it once was, both for our brand and for theirs? So these are some of the things you think about with relationships. The ideas for testing relationships, obviously who you work with is a big one, but what about all this? What about the words you use to describe that relationship? Is it a partner? Is it a sister site? Is it a friend of our business? Is it a supporting, you know, actor in all of our plan? The place, where do you put them? Is it on a partner page buried in your press section, buried in your About Us? Or is it front and center? Does it get real estate on the homepage to show who you work with that you think is also doing awesome stuff? And when you do have this awesome partnership with another company and showcase it, how do your potential consumers or visitors react to those relationships? Probably acts as a trust signal for you. And we all know how important it is to validate trust signals. Photos, are you just presenting partnerships in text? What about showing the shaking of a hand or you guys drinking a beer together? All of a sudden that relationship has greater meaning because you guys really are friends and this is a true commitment to each other's companies, right? The who we talked about, the context, what you put around it, what have you talked about it as the future, like this partnership just launched, what are we gonna do in the future? Or is it just kind of the context about this was an acquisition or we announced it, right? It doesn't hold the same meaning as saying, here's what we plan to do together. And then video. Video is a great medium to show off the companies that you work with. You know, Wistia does a great job with this. They talk a lot about the companies they touch and the videographers that they work with. And it's because you look at it and you're like, man, all those people over there doing such cool things. I want to be a part of this, you know? So when you see a number of people come together for a similar cause, those partnerships can be very compelling. All right, so number seven, your triggers. This one's a really big one to me. I think you can call triggers whatever you want, calls to actions, activities, conversions. Whatever you think of as a trigger has completely changed in the last year to 2 years, as it was when I used to test things or when a lot of us tested in the past. When you didn't have such an evolved audience, I think changing the color of a button or the size or changing the placement was very effective. And it's not that it isn't effective now, but it's not as effective as a lot of other things. So it's a bigger story to it now. I'm reading a lot of neuromarketing. Marty is a huge fan of this, and we geek out on these conversations. I heard he actually kind of talked a little bit about it yesterday, and it might have been like very traumatizing for all of us because he's just out there and so smart. But neuromarketing is critical to what we do right now in our jobs because everything is a relationship-based and word-of-mouth-based consumer audience. Everything we do is about that. So we all have three brains, right? Most of us know this. But the truth is, most of us don't market to all of them at all, really. And we certainly don't test for all of them. So the three brains, we all know the new brain, that's the rational data. And I would say that most of our tests and most of our time as marketers is spent on this brain, where we say to ourselves, we're going to convince them in sheer logic. We're going to say, well, of course we're the best. We've been around the longest. We have the best data. We have the best resources. We care about the environment, right? This is all logical justification. And then you have what's called the middle brain, and this was the emotional part. And maybe we say stuff like, you should do this because it's good for you and your family, or you should do this because a part of the proceeds go to a nonprofit, right? It's something that triggers at your heartstrings. This third part is the part that many of us forget about, and it's the part that makes all the decisions. And that's the reptilian brain. And I just heard Amy Africa discuss this at a conference a couple weeks ago in a brilliant explanation. I gave a link down at the bottom so you can learn more about the reptilian brain. But this is the one that controls all decision. And the reptilian brain is the oldest of all our brains, and it's the one that is really about hunger, sleep, safety. And you have to be testing a full story that hits all of these. And here's some examples on people that are not and why. So say I wanted to go build a website, I go to Wix. This would definitely hit my new brain, right? It's logical. I can choose a design, I can customize it with ease. I wouldn't say anything here is particularly compelling emotionally, but it gets the job done logically. And you look at Jindu, same thing. I would say that I feel kind of safe about the decision if I went with them. It looks valid. They've got some great trust signals here at the bottom. And then you look at Yola, same thing. I can watch a demo, a lot of the steps that I have as a consumer decided I must do before triggering or making a decision. But what about this? What about Squarespace? That is an epic website. That is an epic homepage. Because you look at it, and it has everything. Free 14-day trial with 24/7 support, no credit card required. New brain, tackled. Reptilian brain of safety, tackled. But then, everything you need to create an exceptional website. I don't even know what this dude's doing with his fountain pen and his paper, but I really would like to do it. I would like to go join him in that studio, hold a fountain pen, and just do something exceptional. I don't even know what that has to do with the website because it's a fountain pen. But anyways, these are not important questions because I've already been triggered. I'm going to go deeper. I come to this website. I'm going to check out the tour. Absolutely guaranteed. So think about that when you're setting up your tests. Are you just setting up tests to improve how you trigger them on a logical side, on an emotional side, or on a raw, very pure side of, is this a safe, awesome, epic thing to do? You have to think about all that with testing these days. All right, your UVP. This one's really fun. It is different than your pillars, and it's different than your story. A unique value proposition, we all know, is the concept that you have something your competitor does not. And I think we're all pretty good. We know we need to put that somewhere pretty prominent, right? And I think that we all know that at some point, we probably should be optimizing for those. The problem is most marketers think optimizing for your UVP is making it bigger and putting it in more places. And that's not exactly the case. So here's a great company. We all know them. They do great things. Let's keep in mind that their UVP a couple years ago was powered by service and customer service, the culture of service. They have since very much kept that as part of their identity, but expanded and tested many other UVPs. If you were to go in and look at their running shoes, which I do every other hour, and you were to see here free shipping both ways, 365 day returns, right? That's their UVP here. If you go, however, to their juniors clothing section, you're gonna see that they're gonna really call out get it tomorrow. So they have multiple UVPs. They've sat in a room and decided what do we offer really, really well that our competitors are not doing as great at? And let's see if we can't match those with where that audience might need it in that certain section of the site. So it's a multi-tiered analysis of your UVP. And the other thing here is to really think about, powered by service was great when everyone else's customer service sucked. But then people started to up their game. Their competitors started to get better, and they put money to it, right? They threw money at it so that people knew that customer service was a big thing for other brands. And they actually looked and said, maybe that shouldn't get all the real estate. Maybe we should try other things. So that's what I mean when I say you need to test your UVP. Pottery Barn does a great job of this. Very smart. Now, they do have great shipping. I don't know if any of the people in the audience shop with them. I certainly do at the holidays. But they're matching it to what you're coming in for. So if you're looking at candles, they understand that free shipping is going to be a big deal because candles aren't expensive as some other things. So you don't want to spend twice as much on shipping as you would the product. But they also look at this and you say, OK, pricing is also very much a UVP for Pottery Barn. Compared to a lot of their competitors, they are far less expensive, right, on the home decor side, especially for the quality of the stuff. I'm not endorsed to say that. But if you look at that, they're going to call out the $49 price point. So I think you have to really be going deeper and saying, yes, we might be really awesome at this one thing, but it doesn't match everything we sell or everything we're trying to do, and try to optimize for those. So this last part that has been cut off is the most important. In a way that is different from your competitors, you need to be evaluating if what was unique about you 3 months ago is still unique, or if the audience and your competitors have caught up. And if so, it's time to evolve. And some of that is a culture change. Some of it is going to the tippity top and saying, we need to get better at something else. Our competitors have caught up. And that's a really hard but very, very critical conversation to have. All right, number five, your schedule. So this one's my favorite because we just don't spend a lot of time optimizing our schedules as marketers. Because we're like, am I alive today? Like, did I get through this crazy week? I'm winning, right? Like, my schedule is being a success. But I think that when you actually look at what you need to get done and what you want to improve at your company, very often it comes down to the schedule you've set up. So what do you have scheduled at your companies right now? Social, when you push out things socially. I know that our community team recently redid the way that they scheduled things. When you go onto Facebook and ask a question, you ask it on a Saturday and you get a bunch of response. Have you tested asking it on a Sunday? When you go in on Tuesday and ask for feedback from your community on how the tools are going, have you tried it on other pages or on other days, and have you tried it at other times? What audiences are you capturing when you schedule these sort of outreaches with your community? Email strategy, so your lifecycle marketing strategy. Right now you have emails going out at certain triggers in your lifecycle. When was the last time you tested that? We have a free trial, and I can tell you we went a good 8 months before we started testing whether or not they should get it on a weekly basis in the first 4 weeks of the trial, or if they should get it every other week, or what those emails should say. These are all things you need to be testing consistently to see progress. The outreach part we've talked a little bit about today, but just as SEOs, we all know, you have a process you do. You send a request, or you reach out to someone, show them something cool, and you know when you're going to follow up. When was the last time you tested how and when you followed up? Performance marketing, I'm not going to go too crazy into it right now, but it's near and dear to my heart. And I know that there are certain days, I mean, I would go years where there would be certain, I'd be on a schedule where certain days I would go in and change my bids, or certain times of the quarter I would go in and add landing pages. And you have to sit and say to yourself, maybe it's time to mix that up. See if I'm leaving something out there that I really should be changing. The content strategy, this one I think we're all pretty good at, but sometimes it's just good to go in and say, wow, when we push out our content, maybe we should be pushing out at a different time. Maybe that follow-up tweet should be at a different time. And then the revamp. So just in general, when you revamp things, we get into this really annual or quarterly process as marketers where we say, you know, Q1 is about this, Q2 is about revamping these three channels, Q4 is about revamping these two channels because it's slower. And we kind of like get it in our head. And even when we switch jobs, we kind of stick with that schedule. And you have to change it. You have to say to yourself, maybe I should move that up or switch it around or try to do more this quarter because we're going to get more from it for the rest of the year. So think about your schedule and think about where there are places that you can be optimizing how you're doing that. All right, number four, your tools. Again, something that seems very meta, right? Like in CRO, optimizing for which tools you use. Critically important and very challenging because when we find a tool that we like as marketers, we like hold on to that tool. Like if they change it or if there's a pricing change, we get like really freaked out because we love it, and we know how to use it really well, and we're the one that knows how to use it at the company, so we're super valuable. But you have to be looking at the tools that you use for CRO and asking yourself if they're still the best tools on the market. Because this is a market that is evolving literally as one of the fastest, I think, in marketing. The tools out there now, if I had had them years ago, I mean, it's really mind-boggling. So for the love of good coffee, stop using crappy tools. And we know what the crappy CRO tools are out there. And luckily, some of them are going away, right? Like GWO is going to be going away. So I think that that's going to push a lot of people that are comfortable with very basic, primitive CRO tools to step up their game. There's some great ones out there. So what makes for like CRO tool euphoria? If you were to look at your tool belt and say, what tools do I have hooked up to my site so that everyone here knows how to use them? What are they covering? Well, one, hopefully they are at some point very affordable. And the reason is for that is because testing very often gets cut. And when testing gets cut, they look at the tool price, and then they decide if they're going to cut it. There are a lot of great CRO tools out there that are very affordable, if not free. Feedback, you need to have a tool that gets you some sort of epic feedback, whether that be a surveying tool or whether that be some kind of tool that you've hacked out in-house. Maybe you're just using SurveyMonkey. That would be considered a CRO tool, right? Analytics, we all have a pretty strong sense on that, but more than just GA and site search, there should be some sort of analytical piece where you can actually see some great graphs, get some great metrics, share with a grander team. It's the only way they're going to care about CRO is if they see something that's very pretty. We all know about data and how you present it and how people want to see data. Usability is very important, obviously. We've spent a lot of time recently at SEO Moz working on usability. Jackie and Courtney at our company have just been looking at a mass amount of tools. Maybe we can actually get one of them to put up a blog post. That'd be pretty sweet. Built-in logic. So a lot of the tools out there have built-in logic now in tests, where it's, if you run two things against each other, there starts to be a winner, or maybe they can actually extract things about the test that aren't winning. So look for tools that are doing what I would consider like second-tier logic, where they're actually presenting you with findings so that you don't have to spend all your time trying to get the data, like data mine for the findings yourself. There's a lot of tools out there that have them. There should be a contact team before with CRO tools. Very often, if we found a tool we liked, there was no one to call if we were confused. Totally not the case anymore. There's usually great resources with these tools where they're telling you what to test and they're putting out great white papers or they're putting up great blog posts. The companies out there in CRO know how important it is, and they're evangelizing it like crazy. You look at someone like Unbounce, if you read their blog, I mean, it's one of the best things I can read on my daily basis, right, or my weekly basis, because the ideas I get for tests are just through the roof. So think about that. Here's some great tools. Obviously, I just threw up a couple of favorites and ones that we use at SEO Moz, but I really like to look at it in that, you know, three-pronged approach where I say to myself, you need to be testing usability prior to even possibly launching, but if not, after launch is fine. Your landing pages are critical. We know that. Most of us spend all our time in this mid-bucket, which is unfortunate because there's so much other stuff to do. And then activity, right? And I would say that many of us push activity, again, outside of our wheelhouse. This would be something like navigation through a site, heat mapping, click tracking, right? Eye mapping. And the problem with that is it's not outside of our wheelhouse anymore. This is very much our job to do. And if you want to be the critical person on your team, you need to understand these tools. You need to be the person that's able to look at the pages and say exactly why something isn't working, rather than just, I don't think it's working. So those are some great tools. I put up some great resources at the bottom as well. All right, your thank you. This is something in the past 6 months I've just started to really tackle. Renee is in the room somewhere. She is our retention marketer, SEO Moz. Her and I have geeked out many conversations on this. She's quite brilliant at retention and loyalty marketing. And I think that this is something that I have never done prior to coming to SEO Moz. I've never tried to optimize the way I say thank you to a customer. This wasn't something I did. It was someone else's job. Customer service, maybe. Community and social, possibly. But it is absolutely a performance marketer, an inbound marketer, a digital marketer's job to know how your company says thank you and what that loyalty experience looks like. Here's some bad examples. Sorry if anyone in the room is from PayPal. What is this? Like, I got so mad. It was like a thanks from PayPal email, and I opened it up, and this dude is like smiling at me all creepy. And I was like really frustrated by it because, well, he's creepy, and he like stuck with me for like the whole day. But not only that, what value does this bring me? Like, absolutely nothing. A learn more link, really? That's going to be the action, is for me to learn more? Yeah, let me stop what I'm doing at SEO Moz to go learn more about PayPal. Like, no. Hot yoga. So I try to convince myself occasionally that I'm going to like be healthy and do yoga. I never do, but I keep joining. I keep like asking yoga places around town if they have like discounts. So I did this while I was gone last week. I sent an email, and they sent this to me, and I was like infuriated. Probably won't go do yoga there, so this will be my excuse, but God forbid if they send me a link to the schedule or like, you know, anything useful. They don't do anything here but give me my username and password. If you're going to send me an email, you better give me something useful in it. If I'm going to open this and give you time to get through my inbox zero, there better be something really awesome in there for me. Clearly not done here. Here's a great example. Chill did an awesome job. I don't know if anyone's really familiar with Chill in the audience, but the site's very much a YouTube experience, but with a lot more sharing and reviews. And it's really cool. You should check it out. It's kind of newer this year. Anyways, they just said, thank you, it's our month anniversary, and here, watch some awesome video. And it's this dog, and I go, and you watch it, and it's just like a video about a dog, and it's kind of funny. It in no way left me with anything more than a smile, but I certainly felt thanked. I mean, they took the time to send me this email and say, it's our anniversary, right? Heartstrings, reptilian brain, very excited. And then Sephora, I think they do a great job. I purchased from them a lot. But I think they did a great job here, right? Tell us what the experience was like. And again, the Sephora store experience. So they sent this to me after I bought in the store. So they're starting to better understand the movement between the online and offline experience. But also, they're giving me some of the other things. One, trust signals, reminding me how awesome they are, giving me navigation, making it cute, making it kitschy. All these things make me want to stay with them because an email from them doesn't bore me to death. So think about those things. How are you saying thank you to people? And how could you improve that thank you? Your feedback avenues, very closely related, but very, very critical, right? So as a marketer, I spend 80 to 90% of my time trying to get someone to do something and convert. Over the past year, that has changed, right, to more like 50-50, where half of my day I'm trying to think about how can I get them to do something, and half the day I can think about how can I know if it did it, if I did it well? How can I know if, like, we failed them, right? And very often, a lot of the feedback at companies, we all know, are kind of housed in other departments. And so it involves actually getting up from your desk and taking off your headphones and asking someone what's going on in their department and how could we improve. And these are all feedback channels. And I would say with authority, but if you're not thinking about the feedback of your customers or your visitors, you're not doing your job as a marketer, right? You can't just succeed as a marketer by doing half the job. So if you look at actual companies right now and say to yourself, where do they give me the chance to engage with them and give feedback? I love this site, but I came here and I thought to myself, I was like, I want to shoot them a question about something that was completely on the marketing side. I wanted to ask them, hey, if I wanted to talk to someone on your marketing team, who should I email? It was so hard. Why are you so small? It was so hard to find their contact information. They buried it in the footer in the smallest font possible because they want me to do this. Well, I've already done that. So what about my second conversion, people? What about the time I'm supposed to connect with you as a person and a human? When did we start leaving that off the table, you know? And then you look at someone, so I buy a lot of watches. I love how my entire presentation is about my shopping habits. And where is it? I literally wanted to ask them a question about the size of this watch and not one link when I was in a deep product page, not one way, not even from the footer, nothing, could I ask them a question. What? Raise your fist in the air, people. Unacceptable, right? But then you look, and some people do it really well. This is a small little company. It's called Apple. Talk to a specialist now. If you have a question, this is only a phone number, mind you, right? It's not even live chat. But the way that they've worded it, the placement they've put it at, makes me feel really safe. It's also a small company. You guys probably never heard of them. But we put live chat right here on our billing page. And if we're not there, it's leave a comment. If we are there, it's live chat with the customer service team. And I think it's really critical because we're still figuring out what the main problems are with this page. It's a great way for us to know what we need to change because the questions that come through here directly affect the tests that I run. So your feedback avenues are critical. Here are some things that you should be looking at and trying to improve all the time. One, your analytics. I am amazed at the number of sites that don't have site search, which is fine. Sometimes it aesthetically doesn't work. But if you don't have site search, what are you using? Where are you finding out the specific hardcore questions that customers have when they come to your site? Survey tools, live chat, cancellation forms. If you're not a SaaS company, it can be a return form for a product. When you have failed someone, how often are you as a marketer going and looking at those forms and saying, got it, we need to fix this, we need to fix this, we need to fix this. Help tickets, listening tools, right? It's very time consuming, but very effective to go out and see where people are complaining about you on the web. It's incredibly helpful when you're trying to ask yourself, what should we prioritize? Because if someone takes the time to actually go out to a Quora or Facebook and complain about you and get other people riled up, you should probably go address that problem first. All right, number one. So we're down to the number one thing, your biggest success. There's absolutely no reason to have a huge cow picture on this slide. Other than I just loved him and I wanted him to go up there. And I tried to come up with like a story and how it would relate to a cow, but there's nothing. So number one thing that you should try to improve, your best performing thing, your biggest success. Shriek, freak out. That's what most people do. I've put together some math. I would like to put up a disclaimer slide that I'm in no way a scientist. You guys have met the scientist who spoke the other day. It's Matt Peters. I'm not as smart as that man, but I have attempted some very important math, which isn't actually math, but looks like math. And this is what it means. And literally, that's not math. That doesn't mean anything. Dare to change your best performers for more win in less time. So as marketers, our scrappiness makes us want to go after the lowest hanging fruit. Because we say to it, I don't need a lot of resources. Just give me a couple minutes of like that guy's time. Give me like 3 hours on Friday. Like, I'm going to throw together something. I think this could be big. And that's a really valuable trait. It's also more time consuming, less payoff initially, possibly. If you go after the best performing thing, the page that is really nailing it, it gets most of your traffic, or you know, maybe it's a product page that is absolutely, the conversion rate's through the roof, I don't know. One of those things, and say to yourself, I'm gonna go change this. First of all, when you tell other people you wanna go change it, they're gonna say no. But this is what you really need to do to shake up a company's culture and say, we're gonna test some serious things. Because most traffic goes there, most purchases happen there. If you improve it by that small percent, right? It's the law of bigger numbers. It's everything. Your year will be made just by optimizing those bigger things. So it's a challenge, and it's something that's a little bit risky. But I think that, I mean, this is the type of industry we're in, right? Like, go big or go home. You have to tackle these bigger things. If you leave your really good performers out to rest and just let them sit there and focus on all these smaller performers, right, these less performing things, you will not get where you could get if you just tackled this guy. It will take you 2 years to get where you would if you nail this one over here. So think about that when you're trying to decide what you're going to go after next. All right, that was a lot. I'm a little out of breath. But there's a lot of things that can help. And I think that over the last couple years, when I've really said to myself, why can't we get this testing culture up and moving? Like, what can it be? What can we do to get people really excited about testing? Here are some things I've learned. So one, stop setting up tests. If you are in a meeting and you say, let's just set up a test, you've killed it. You've absolutely shot yourself in the foot. No one has time to set up tests. No one has time to support the setting up of tests. This is absolutely 100% true. So I don't care if it's a semantic thing and you call it something else and say, well, maybe we should validate that. I don't care if it's like, I love your idea. I think we should totally go after that and see if it would win if we put it up against this. I don't care how you conversationally do it, but stop setting up tests. It makes it a finite lifetime to that test. And once it's done, even if you get it through, like everyone around you is going to be like, well, we ran that test last quarter. I mean, don't you think we should work on other things? And it's like, oh, sad pants. So stop waiting for the resources. I think that we can talk about this at SEO Moz. You know, we have this great creative team. They're tasked, I can see Derek in the back, tasked with a lot of things. Everything you've seen at this entire conference has been done by three people in the creative team. That's a lot. So when I like roll over to Derek's desk, I'm like, hey, how about we like change the homepage image up? Or like, let's go nestle this video in a different like frame set. And he's just like, yeah, right? Like, I haven't slept in 2 weeks. So if you wait for the resources, you're probably not gonna get there. Other ways to do it are to outsource, to try to find the funds to set up a separate kind of isolated testing environment where you can say, we have people that are willing to do this and get buy off, or make it part of the roadmap and say, Q1 is XYZ. Q2 is all about validation, customer feedback, right, semantics, and then Q3 is this. So that you get that time in there, it's not something you bring in after. It can't be a layer after everything else. It will never get the priority. Stop owning it. So I know Jen had a slide almost identical to this in her presentation I saw on Twitter, and I love that because I think that that is so SEO Moz, is I am very much a independent worker. Like, I like to kind of work on things. And I think that marketers in general, we're pretty ambitious people, and it's really awesome to be the person that walks in and comes up with the one test that makes the entire company succeed, because that so often happens, right? But realistically, that never happens. And so it has to be a team effort. And I pick these photos because I can literally say in the last 3 months, I've had conversations about testing with every single one of them. And very much, like, Jackie's actually just almost all the time thinking about how can we test and validate. And she's working with other departments. And only then does it become less about a test and more about a culture. And it's hard conversations to have because you think to yourself, no, it needs to be controlled. It's a test is a very complicated, robust thing. But hopefully, as you look at the last 10 things that we talked about, they're not. There are these huge, big-ass questions that you need to tackle, and that can't be done with one person. It can't be done with one person's resources or one person's time or one person's brain. So stop owning it. It's more of a team effort. Stop pushing pennies. The very smart Tom Critchlow actually was the person that kind of, I think, bitch slapped me once when I was like, he kind of asked me my ideas for tests, and I like sent him this long email with test ideas, and I like felt so proud. And he came back, he's like, think bigger. That's all he wrote back. Very busy, that one. And he loves his inbox zero. But it's so true, because I like to move things. I like to see progress. So I come up with these ideas like, let's come up with a rotating testimonials. We should test the testimonials. Probably not the testimonials themselves. Probably should test whether or not it's a video or text. Should probably test if it's a homepage or an entire subsite that's called proof, you know? So think about that. Stop pushing pennies. No one makes money by pushing pennies. Stop stopping. So this one's obviously kind of self-explanatory, but it has to be said, because there's something about testing. There's something about everything else that gets put on our plate that when it comes down to say, I really think we should test this, and you write down in your notebook, and, or you type it in your computer in your meeting, you're like, test this. And it never gets looked at again, because too many things come up. And you want to be the critical person that did this over here, or you want to be involved. But this makes all of this better and worth more money, so it's so important. I love this quote, which you guys kind of can't see, but part of determining your value is how determined you are to being valuable and to giving value, right? So if you are determined to making your culture test-driven, validation-driven, you will absolutely get there. If you find excuses for it, why the hell should your company care? Why should they give any of their time or resources to it? If the marketers, the ones that are in charge of performance and increasing the success of a website, if they don't care. So stop stopping. So let's wrap this party up in about 8 minutes, so we'll actually have some time for questions. What is conversion rate optimization these days? Like, what is it? Engagement optimization. Story optimization. What are you doing with these? With your story, how are you putting your best foot forward? How are you selling it so hard that no one can ignore it? Relationship. What are you doing with those relationships? How are you getting the right people working with you, and how are you making sure that those collaborations, the world knows about them? Those collaborations are so creative that it can't be ignored. Process optimization, whether it be your tools or your schedule, I don't care what it is, but if you're using the one you used 2 years ago, you're doing it wrong. So think about that. Value optimization. Is the best foot forward really your best foot? Or all your competitors catch up? Is it time to go somewhere else? Take it someplace different, right? Loyalty optimization, new to a lot of us, scary for most of us. I still don't know what I'm doing half the time. Thank goodness Renee's there. But how are you saying thank you? How are you following up? What's the feedback loop look like? How are you using those to drive what you do next? How you test it, what it looks like, how it sounds? It's more than running tests. We have to think bigger. Our competitors are thinking bigger. Companies are putting more money at it. Companies are building awesome tools. We are literally the only ones holding back from these really beautiful, amazing websites. We just have to think bigger. So that's me. Thanks for listening to me ramble. Thank you.
I am completely inspired to,
get on Pinterest.
Yeah, to get on Pinterest.
Is everyone inspired to get on Pinterest?
To go do a whole bunch of work, to go say thank you to my clients, to go figure out how to be valuable and look as good as you.
Right.
I am.
It's also about shoes.
Yes, everyone's tweeting about your shoes, by the way.
Nice.
Okay, questions.
Right back here.
First one's back there.
So if you can share, what are some of the key metrics you're using to measure your acquisition and also your loyalty?
Yeah, so that's an awesome question. So you and I should have a drink later. So we've actually been talking a lot about what metrics we use for how we stand in acquisition. As you know, we all kind of took funding a little while ago, and we've been working with Brad at the Foundry Group, and he's been really pushing us to take the metrics that we use as our touchstones and consolidate them. So we're down to like the bare bones, right? Like we're looking at things like net ads as a sign of success. And what I think is so interesting about that is it takes away a lot of the CPAs and the CPCs. Like Justin and I, like we're performance backgrounds, I'm used to just looking at my CPA. Like I want to move my CPA. I want to get my CPA lower no matter what happens. Well, guess what? You can get a hell of a lot lower and that quality can still suck, right? So I think that what's really interesting about that is we're starting to look at things that not soft metrics anymore, right? They're very much important metrics, but things like the customer feedback forms, the sentiment, net promoter scores, things where we're asking our customers if they think we're doing well. You know, we put on Facebook, what's your favorite thing that we're doing? What could we improve on? These are metrics we're using. We're sending it to all staff, and we're saying to ourselves, wow, guys, look at that. 100 people responded. Only 8 people said that they think this tool could use improvement, or that, you know, when we decided what are our best tools for customers, I have so much data. Casey next to you built a tool for us so that we can understand which tools people are using. And that's really awesome. But take that and put with it the qualitative data of them saying, not only do I use those 3 tools, but I can't live without this tool. Suddenly, Adam and his team know which tool they need to improve. So I think that, to kind of touch on the acquisition side, it's become a very much a combo effort between what I would call traditional kind of C-level metrics, right, all your Cs, and then this more qualitative form of feedback, which is why we're kind of going that direction. On the retention side, very challenging. It's very challenging, but I think that luckily our customer service team is on it. So they do a weekly kind of summary. Maybe we can get Aaron to do a blog post on it, where he kind of talks about these are the scores they've given us on how we're doing. Here are the things that people have canceled because of. Here's the downtime on these tools. So we're getting a full, straight from the customer kind of metrics on what's failing for them and what's working, which is really different than saying which of our pages do our most loyal users visit the most. It's very different. So it's a challenge, but I think that we're trying to explore some more of this straight from the horse's mouth type of data. It's been really effective for us. Hi.
Hello. I want to say that it's really admirable that you guys made retention, loyalty, and gratitude like a core part of your business. And I really like the idea of a job title, the retention marketer. So one challenge I see is for a lot of SaaS companies, retention is something that kind of cuts across departments. You know, it's sales, it's marketing, account management. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about how you were able to kind of bring cohesion and consolidate your retention efforts within SEO Moz.
Group hugs. There's a lot of group hugging going on at SEO Moz. Cupcakes. No, it is such a challenge, and actually one that we're still kind of struggling with. I think so. One thing we've done at SEO Moz that was very effective for us, I'm not so sure if it will be effective for everyone, but we have Renee, who's our retention marketer, and she does live in marketing, but we built a retention team, which is a cross-company department team. So we have someone from product on there. We have Karen from product. We have Aaron from a help team. We have Matt Peters, who's our data scientist. Casey, who is our web developer. I'm going to forget a lot of people right now. We have Katie, who's a product manager. Karin, who comes in and joins us sometimes. So we all get in a room, and we talk about what does retention and loyalty and customer feedback look like on each team, which has been awesome. Literally enlightening for everyone. And we've actually talked about how we're going to change that next year so that that sort of data and information can kind of get spread to the whole company. Because I feel like when we're in that room and we're talking, I'm like, oh, I get it. So like over in marketing, this wasn't working for us, but customer service was hearing this. That's totally different problems from the same cause. So for us, I think that whether it be a full team at a company or whether it just be an email digest, or whether it just be a mention in an all-hands meeting quarterly, you need to be cross-evangelizing what you're finding and your biggest challenges, because coworkers want to help coworkers, and we all want to help the customers. So some level of communication has to happen, and not one team can own it. Absolutely not. Yeah. Good question, though. That's, like, really hard. Yeah. You, sir, who, like, looks behind him, he's like, or maybe you. I don't know. Casey, did you just gallop? I think Casey just, you got Casey Henry to gallop. That was, well done you.
My question is, you mentioned earlier in the presentation that more and more frequently online are asked to engage with offline activities, bricks and mortar stores, volunteers, etc. Sadly, Google Analytics doesn't cover offline activity. So just curious on how that you would look at tracing the success of offline activities by, you know, sort of through driving them through websites, etc.
Yeah, absolutely. So, and in fact, I would urge you to grab John Coleman from after this session because they're tackling this REI. But some of the things that I think you really need to think about is, one, when someone leaves your website, your best data, right, is what they've clicked and what they've done and how they've engaged. But the problem is we don't know exactly the tie to getting them to come into a store. You can get a sense of asking in the store, right? Some sort of like, where did you hear about us? Or, you know, loyalty, and try to tie back to some sort of social connection. So you can get a sense of, are the people that's coming into your store, are they social? Are they digital? Are they early adopters? Are they moving in that same realm? But the main question you can kind of do is keep that. That's what lifecycle marketing is all about. That's what email marketing is, the crux of that sort of on and offline experience. Because once you capture that email, you get a sense, like you look at what Sephora did, and they're asking me about their store experience. Well, when I go into their store, I can easily search anything online, right? Like they have the iPads, I can go in and look at different products. So I think that it's about training right now. We're in the point where it's about training our consumers to understand that these are just two vehicles that touch very much each other. And so when it comes to knowing how it's working, I'm not a total expert, like we don't have an off-store experience. But I can certainly tell you that going to things like this and just customer feedback of like, hey, you know, we switched up the blog, or we made some changes to UMOZ or Q&A, like what are you thinking? Like that sort of direct feedback, whether it be in survey form, email form, or just verbal form, is the best thing you can do right now to understand, are you serving them? Are they doing both? Because if they're like, oh, I haven't visited in a while, then you kind of get a sense of how high touch point they are with both of those vehicles. And right now, I think it's very much just an ask and understand feeling. On the performance marketing side of things, you have a lot more tools, right? Like click to call and things like that. But when you're talking about inbound marketing, you're trying to understand if someone you meet is really getting value of what you're doing online. That's really, it's really gray area right now. I would say email marketing is your best asset, right? So, sorry, it's not super helpful. John, where are you in here? He's somewhere. I'll make him answer it. Maybe we'll have him do a blog post. I've set up 3 blog posts for you guys during this session. So, I think we're done? Yeah?
Thank you. That was awesome.